When we think about the global economy, we think about the United States and China as being the dominant drivers of that activity. In the United States, we remain optimistic on the level of activity for that economy. The Federal Reserve is tightening policy, but at a very moderate pace, and conditions are still quite easy for corporations to prosper. In China, we've seen some fiscal tightening recently, and that has had a bit of an impact on the economy as it relates to specific areas like the property sector. But the authorities just this week have announced some stimulatory policy which will help corporations and will help that structural rebalancing of the economy and also infrastructure, which is a good outcome for Australia. We think the Australian economy is positioned in a good place, but not an exciting place. We think that the Australian community need to get used to more moderate levels of economic activity. We've seen recently that the GDP on a quarter-on-quarter basis can get up towards 3%, but we think those sorts of pulses in the economy are going to be short-lived. We think the economy needs to get more accustomed to around a 2.5% growth rate. The reason for that is that the Australian economy carries a heavy burden on its shoulders, primarily in the household sector with respect to household debt levels. And so servicing those household debt levels becomes difficult for Australians when wage growth or income growth at the household level is at record lows. The bond market is sending some important signals for risk. The bond market has held a fairly contained range in recent times. We have expected, with the pickup in global growth and activity, that bond yields would move higher at a more rapid pace, but they're staying at still relatively low levels. And so that tells you that the bond market is cautious about the sustainability of global activity and the stability of the financial system. Another segment of the bond market, the credit market, has also faced some price pressure in the last 6 months. So after a really good run for around 18 to 24 months preceding, the corporate or credit market has moved to expensive valuations, and now we've seen a recalibration of that risk as this uncertainty for the next 6 to 12 months has crept into market expectations. We feel that the unwinding of quantitative easing around the world will impact bond markets, but it will be a gradual grind on bond markets rather than a big bang impact. Quantitative tightening now has commenced in the United States. So the Federal Reserve is beginning to reduce its balance sheet, but it is doing that at a very measured pace. But what you should acknowledge is that that committed buyer of treasuries has now shifted to ultimately a committed seller. Now they're not directly selling bonds into the market, they're letting securities that mature run off their book. But nonetheless, it's one less buyer in the marketplace. And so that should put some upward pressure on yields in the United States, and the United States often dictates the trend for bond yields around the world. In Europe, we're seeing them taper their quantitative easing. So around the end of this year, they will not commit any more to asset purchases, but their quantitative tightening is probably some way off from that point on. So we think that there's still plenty of excess liquidity around the world looking for a home, and so that will continue to keep overall yields lower, but otherwise grinding a little bit higher in the medium to long term. When we think about fixed income as a diversifier for broader asset portfolios, we tend to move away from the traditional benchmark index. The traditional benchmark index has changed significantly over the last decade or so. The level of sensitivity to interest rates has increased dramatically, but also we are increasingly allocating more capital towards the most indebted countries and corporates around the world. That's not a good mix for investors. So we don't see traditional benchmark indices as a good diversifier for fixed income portfolios. As active managers, what we focus on is getting the right risk factors in the portfolio that will act as a diversifier when other asset classes, such as your growth asset classes in equities or maybe property, etc., start to face some price pressure, the bond market part of your portfolio continues to perform. Absolute return investing is really about moving away from traditional benchmark indices where you have an inherent beta or sensitivity to interest rates. Absolute return investing for us means flexibility in terms of underlying investment strategies. It's not unconstrained, we're still operating within a specific risk objective and a performance target, but we're really quite flexible in terms of our investment universe, where we can invest and how we can invest, overweight and underweight certain markets, and also having symmetry around cash. At the end of the day, we feel that investors for absolute return really focus on cash as their ultimate benchmark. And so that's our objective, to outperform cash over the medium to long term.